Hi, welcome to Operating Multi-Tenant Kafka Services for Developers. So this is the agenda for the talk. I'm going to give you a little intro about myself and Heroku Data. I'm going to look at the motivation behind building the multi-tenant Kafka service in general. Take a look at our existing single-tenant Kafka, compare that with multi-tenancy, what the multi-tenancy implications are. And then we'll go into some of the configuration changes that we made and some of the tuning that we did. Talk a little bit about testing, and then hopefully cover automation, which is kind of our thing, and discuss some of the limitations that were necessary as a result of making a multi-tenant service. So I'm Ali Hamidi. I'm an engineer on the Heroku data team at Salesforce. Heroku is a cloud platform that enables companies to build applications in a variety of languages, deploy it on our platform, and actually it helps them to run it, scale it, monitor it. Heroku Data specifically is the team at Heroku that provides the data services on top of it. And so we provide Heroku Postgres, Heroku Redis, and Kafka, of course. So a brief about Kafka. Hopefully many of you are aware of it already. Kafka itself is an Apache project. It's a distributed streaming platform. It provides the pub-sub model. In Kafka parlance, it's produce and consume. So you produce the cluster, and you consume from it. It's a durable message store. So on disk, it's a ordered commit log. And it's highly available. So you have multiple brokers that can hold multiple replicas of your data. And so if a single broker goes down, you still have replicas, and it'll fail over, and you continue. And so what is Apache Kafka on Heroku, specifically? So we provide a fully managed service. So it's more of a batteries-included approach. It's opinionated in the sense that in cases where there are multiple configuration options, we make a decision based on what we feel is a safe or productive default, and we provide that out of the box. It's configured for best practices for most users. And I put a little asterisk because there's no, you can't make one size fits all. There are bound to be use cases that aren't really well suited, but we try to cover as many as possible and try to get the largest coverage as possible. And so I want to talk a little bit about the use cases for Kafka in general. So why would you use Kafka and not some other data store or other streaming service? And so I'm going to cover a couple of use cases and then look at specific customers that were on Heroku that use Heroku Kafka. So one of the ones I'm going to look at is decomposing a monolithic app. And so in this case, we're taking a big monolith, and we're using Kafka as a transport medium or an interconnect between the various services or microservices to transport information and events between them. Another use case that I'm going to cover is processing high volume, real-time data streams. So you may have something that is naturally a stream of events, so like currency information or events coming from an IoT device or whatever it is, and you just have a torrent of data that you're collecting from various sources, and you want to make real-time decisions on those. And the third use case I'm going to cover is providing real-time event-driven architecture. So this is pretty similar to the second case, but essentially you have a number of disparate services that are producing events, and you're trying to make decisions on some kind of aggregate of that data. So you have a number of sources, they're all telling you different things, and you want to make real-time decisions on what you should be doing. And so for the first case, decomposing the monolith, I'm going to talk a little bit about Shift Commerce. So you can actually read about it. They have a blog post on the Heroku blog that talks about it. And so they basically leveraged Heroku Kafka as a path to gradual migration from a monolith into a microservice. So essentially what they did was they introduced the ability for their monolith to produce events into Kafka. And then gradually over time, they introduced more and more services that consume those events and moved the logic out of the monolith into those new microservices. So for the second use case, I wanted to talk a little bit about Coin. It's pronounced Coin. Coin is a fintech company based out of Singapore, and they mostly deal with cryptocurrency exchanges, and they're mostly active in Japan. And so essentially, they have a huge torrent of pricing data for cryptocurrencies coming from a number of different exchanges. and they aggregate them and sort of make decisions in real time on what to do and how the prices affect their decisions. The last use case I want to cover is Caesars Entertainment, of casino fame and other things. And essentially, they use it to ingest and aggregate a large amount of customer data from lots and lots of different sources. And they use it to make decisions on how best to provide services or offers or deals to their most prized VIP customers. And so these are like very different systems all producing events. They aggregate them, they process them, they try to make decisions on how best to serve their customers. So I want to talk a little bit about the motivation. Why bother building a multi-tenant Kafka? We already have a relatively successful dedicated Kafka product. So these are some of the motivations behind it, some of the goals. Right now, our single-tenant Kafka starts at $1,500 for the base plan, which is the standard zero. And so with that, you get three brokers and five zookeepers, which is kind of a pretty standard for our zookeeper topology. And $1,500 is could be relatively reasonable for you, but we want to lower that barrier. We want to make it much easier to access. And so, if you're working in development, you haven't really finished your product yet, that might be too high a barrier for you. And so, targeting development, testing, low volume production, we want to introduce something that's a little bit more accessible. And so our multi-tenant plans right now start at $100. So that's quite a substantial reduction. So here's the blog post when we announced it. It's September 14th, 2017. So we've had multi-tenant Kafka for quite a while. So I want to talk a little bit about the differences, single-tenant versus multi-tenant, and what it looks like. So single-tenant is pretty obvious. We have one customer or one tenant that has access to the entire cluster. And so your security boundaries or your resource boundaries are really outside of the cluster. Everything in the cluster is yours. And so this is really what it looks like. When you talk Kafka, you're really dealing with topics. So all the topics are owned by a single customer. You don't really need to worry about any isolation at that level. With multi-tenancy, it kind of looks like this. And so we have a large number of customers all residing on a single Kafka cluster. And so that introduces a whole range of new sort of issues that you need to tackle. I know this is kind of a wall of text, but I'm going to break it down and talk about each one separately. So, we talk about resource isolation, we talk about parity, compatibility, and costs related to it. So I'm going to focus on resource isolation first and talk about security implications, performance implications, and safety. So when I talk about security, what I really mean is a tenant should not be able to access another tenant's data. This is kind of table stakes for multi-tenancy. It would be kind of a disaster if we put everyone on the same cluster and everyone could read everyone else's data. So the priority, the main thing is this should not happen. You shouldn't be able to read other people's data. With Kafka, because we actually talk about topics all the time, this is really what we mean. User A shouldn't be able to read user B's topics. And so how do we do that? Kafka itself has native support for access control lists, or ACLs. And so it's a somewhat relatively new feature in Kafka life. But essentially, what it allows you to do is specify user A can carry out action B on resource C. So user A can read or describe or write topic messages, which is owned by user A. But there is no explicit ACL for allowing it to read anything of topic B or user B, so it can't. So the other thing we do is namespacing. So this is something that's somewhat unique to us in that we namespace resources per tenant. So when you create a new multi-tenant Kafka add-on on Heroku, we automatically generate a name. In this case, Wabash 58779. So we pick a river dash some numbers, and that becomes a prefix for all of your resources. So you create the topic messages, you get Wabash whatever it is dot messages. That also applies to the consumer groups. And that's actually what we apply the ACLs to. So any topic that begins with Wabash whatever is owned by tenant A. Anything that has a different prefix is owned by another tenant. So the second aspect of that I want to look into is performance. And what I mean here is really this. A tenant should not adversely affect another tenant's performance. So this is typically what we refer to as the noisy neighbor. So you're sharing a cluster with someone, they're super active, they're absolutely hammering their broker, and your performance goes down the toilet as a result of it. So obviously, that sucks for everyone, except for the person who's abusing the resources. And so we want to prevent that. And so in the case of Kafka, Kafka has support for quotas. So that's super cool. It's really useful. It allows you to specify a produce quota and a consume quota in terms of bytes per second. And so we say, you know, tenant A can have 256 kilobytes per second produce and 1 megabyte per second consume. And Kafka itself enforces that. I'll talk a little bit later about the way that's enforced, because it's kind of interesting. The third part of resource isolation is safety. And so here, what I actually mean is a tenant should not jeopardize the stability of the cluster. So we don't want a single tenant who does something unusual or has a misbehaving client to take down the cluster for everyone else. And so in order to prevent that, we apply limits. And so we can apply limits to topics, and by that I mean the number of topics, and by association, the number of partitions, which is really the thing that scales on Kafka, the number of consumer groups, and storage and throughput. I want to talk a little bit more about storage, because it's kind of interesting. Kafka's concept of storage is more of a transient thing. Messages live on the Kafka cluster for a certain amount of time. They don't live there forever. It's not a source of truth for your data forever. And so thinking of it in terms of static storage is a little bit strange. So instead, we think of it as capacity. And this is a term that we use in all of our documentation. And essentially, that's a function of message throughput multiplied by the retention on all of those messages multiplied by the replication. So if I do 100 messages per second, and I have a one-day retention, and I want 3 replicas of it, then you multiply that all together. And that's actually the total amount of storage you're using across the cluster. And then there's the throughput itself, which I kind of covered with the quotas. And so imposing these limits is cool. Some of them are natively supported within Kafka. So you can specify quotas or ACLs to do certain things. And storage is something that we cover with the capacity, which is this slightly more complicated function. But we need to be able to monitor it. We actually need to be able to look at this and say, are these limits being exceeded? Are they being, adhered to? In particular with storage, the way it works in our case is that we allow you to grow the storage on the cluster. So you spin up a cluster, we give you 100 gigabytes of storage. You start putting data into it, and you get close to the 100 gigabytes. We actually grow it automatically for you. So we don't take down your cluster because you hit your limit. We have a pretty generous grace sort of area where we will, increase the storage and let you continue. But that's great for the customer, but we aren't really doing you any favors by allowing you to grow unbounded. So we actually have to monitor it. And so we check occasionally to see, are you still within the limits? Are you nearing a dangerous limit? And so monitoring is kind of key to that. But then more so than just monitoring is actually being able to enforce the limits. So some of them are nice because they're natively supported in Kafka. But in the case of storage, if our automation automatically grows the volumes, then you can just keep growing forever, and eventually the cluster will topple over. And so we actually have to have a mechanism for enforcing it. So in the case of Kafka multi-tenant, we'll send you an email saying, hey, you've exceeded your storage by 150%. You should probably slow it down or upgrade your plan. And if you keep going past it, then we impose an additional, more aggressive throttling to kind of slow your growth and get you back under the limit. And then if you just fly past it for an extended period of time, we actually block access to try to let it clear out, and then we'll enable it again. So another area of multi-tenancy, which is kind of specific to multi-tenancy, is parity. And so here we're talking about feature parity as well as behavior parity. And so I say parity, but what I really mean is for the service to be useful, it needs to behave like a normal cluster. There's no point in us giving you something that looks and behaves in a way that's totally unlike Kafka, because you could code against it and you could deploy your application against it and it works fine, but then you switch to a regular Kafka and everything breaks and it just doesn't do what you think it does. And so in order to address this, we actually give you access to what is effectively a standard Kafka cluster. It looks very much like our dedicated clusters. It's the same number of brokers. It's the same number of zookeeper nodes. It behaves in exactly the same way. And so one of these things, one of the things that we thought about is that we could have gone with a single broker, single zookeeper option. And that would have been pretty cost effective, and we could do it quite easily. But then the customer will be developing against something that's not really representative of real life. Nobody would deploy a production Kafka cluster with one broker and one zookeeper. And so you won't have exposure to things like rolling restarts or when topics fail over and all that stuff. So your application might work fine with only one. But then once you switch to a real cluster which has eight brokers and they start failing over and things start moving around, your application breaks. So we actually give you access to something that represents what a real production cluster would look like. So if you do move, then your application is ready for it. So there are some limitations. We have to make some compromises in order to provide these, you know, the level of safety that I mentioned earlier. So as much as possible, we try to keep it standard, but there's going to be some things that we have to change. Compatibility is the next thing I want to talk about. In this case, what I really mean is the service needs to support standard clients, no vendor lock-in. So that's absolutely a core part of Heroku's belief. And we only use open source Apache Kafka. It's not a custom fork. There's no weird custom code required on the client side. There's nothing strange that we do in order to enable this. You use absolutely standard clients and whatever your favorite language is. And you can connect to it and you use it. That's kind of a big thing for us, and it applies to all of our data services, really. So the last implication I want to talk about is costs, and specifically costs of resources and the operational cost. So what does it cost to run for the things that we run, like VMs and instances? Plus, what does it cost us to actually operate it? And so here, I'm talking about the service needs to be financially feasible. And in this case, I'm actually talking about our costs, not so much the cost for the customer, although they're obviously related. So here, the things that go into the resource costs would be packing density. How many tenants do we pack on this cluster? And conversely, but somewhat related, is the utilization of that cluster. Like, how well utilized is it? The more utilized it is, the more efficiently we're spending our money on these resources. But with that comes a few sort of interesting cases where we have consciously made a decision to take a hit on our part in order to provide certain functionality. And so when we look at cluster size, we have some options. We could have one massive cluster with hundreds of brokers and pack all of the tenants onto there. Or we could have very, very small clusters, like one broker, one zookeeper. And so there's some decisions there where there are implications related to the way it performs, the way failovers work. There is a sweet spot for cluster size. And we've actually already done this process. We've looked into this. We did all the testing when we looked at the single dedicated plans. And we settled on, you know, a maximum of eight brokers and five zookeepers because of the way it behaves. And so we kind of favor that. We also kind of insisted pretty early on that we don't over-provision. And so when we tell a customer you're signing up for a particular plan, we make sure that they have all those resources. And so we don't over-provision in any way. So again, if we say we're going to pack 20 customers onto a cluster and they all join on with the lowest plan, then our utilization is pretty low. And so that sucks from a resource cost, but it's great from the customer point of view because now they have the resources that they expected. Also, we wanted to provide seamless upgrading. So the idea is a customer can join on with the lowest plan, and they should be able to upgrade to the next plan up or the biggest plan that we have for a multi-tenant without any disruption. And so unfortunately, when it comes to Kafka, there is no easy way to actually migrate offsets. So if you move from one cluster to the other, the offsets aren't really translatable in that sense. So in order to get around this, we have to assume the worst case or the best case, depending on your perspective, that every customer could potentially upgrade to the biggest plan. And so inherently, our utilization is pretty low. When it comes to operational costs, this is kind of the area that we want to focus on because this is the amount of man hours that we sink into it. And we're not a huge team, so this kind of makes a big difference for us. So we want to minimize the operational burden and minimize the impact or the blast radius of particular issues. So again, going back to the cluster size, if we had one massive cluster with 100 brokers and there was a cluster-wide issue, then that could potentially affect hundreds or thousands of customers. And so again, we fall back into the sweet spot of saying, you know, if we have clusters that are 8 brokers and we pack 25, 30 tenants onto it, then we can kind of minimize the blast radius into a particular area. And minimizing operational costs, again, if we match the single tenant clusters and the topology, then we can actually share the learnings between them. So all of the gained knowledge and experience from operating a fleet of 3 and 8 broker clusters, we actually map immediately. And so we find a bug in one sort of topology or one behavior, one performance tuning that works in one, we can immediately map it over to the next, to the multi-tenant without really any loss. Some of the other ways that we kind of reduce the operational burden for us is that we pick safe defaults. So it's possible to kind of put yourself in a unfortunate situation by picking settings that are not ideal. So if you think about the situation where you create a topic and you set replication to 1, which was the default in lots of clusters. So the customer creates a topic and they start writing things to it and we fail over that broker. Well, what happened to the data? It only resided on 1 and so now it's gone forever. That sucks for the customer and maybe they weren't aware of it or maybe they assumed that you know, a sane default was used. So we actually enforce that. So we pick those safe defaults, both to provide a better user experience, but also to reduce the operational burden for us. As I mentioned, we pick similar clusters to our dedicated, so we can share those learnings. And we do a ton of automation. Automation, it's kind of our thing. That's like an epic understatement. We're a very small team, and we manage millions of databases and data services. Millions without exaggeration. That's actually what we do. And we did a ton of testing. We did a huge amount of testing on the multi-tenant topologies, different size Kafka clusters, different configurations, different releases, all sorts of stuff, in order to arrive at a configuration that we think is pretty sound and pretty solid. And that all feeds back into reducing operational costs for us. So I want to talk a little bit about configuration and tuning and sort of talk a little bit about some of the changes that we made, some of the configurations that we did in order to achieve what we aimed to do and what we actually have running in our multi-tenant fleet. So I'm going to cover partitions, the number of partitions, what they look like, quotas, how those work, topics and consumer groups, specifically how they're created, and the idea of guardrails. And so this is something that we kind of implement to make it better for customers to run on Heroku. So partitions. We have tested, and we set a very, very large number of partitions for Kafka. For the most part, like the industry average is maybe 1 or 2,000 partitions per broker. That's kind of like the rule of thumb. We're at close to 6,000. And it's unusually high, but this is kind of the trade-off that we make for being able to pack so many tenants and give them the freedom to create the number of topics that they want or they need and the number of partitions per topic that they need. In order to support a large number of partitions, we actually have to tune the max number of file descriptors. And so all of our clusters run at 500,000, which again is pretty atypical. It's unusually high for brokers of this size. But again, this is, you know, through our testing, our extensive testing, we've arrived at this number, and we know it's a safe number for these clusters. And similarly, we've increased the max memory map count to 500,000. If you look at most Kafka docs, they'll tell you increase it, but to what is kind of up in the air, and it really depends on your usage. I want to cover quotas a little bit, because this is kind of an unusual implementation. And so KIP 13 introduced quotas in 0.9. And something that's kind of counterintuitive, both the enforcement and the way it's implemented in the first place, is that quotas are actually implemented per broker. And so if you think about this, if I set a 1 megabyte per second produce quota on Kafka using the CLI command, what I'm actually getting is 1 megabyte per broker. So then if I think, oh, I've given my customer 8 megabytes, and then I double the size of my cluster, I've actually given them now 16 megabytes. It's not really calculated across the cluster. And if you look at the documentation, they basically say it's easier to implement it this way. And so our quotas are, the quotas documented are actually the cluster-wide aggregate. the enforcement for produce quotas is super counterintuitive and actually caught us out a few times. But the way it works is that when you produce to Kafka, it sends you back a response saying, OK, I got it. It's been written. When the quota's in effect and you've exceeded your quota, it actually does all the work. You know, it accepts your message. It writes it to the commit log. It sends it off to all the brokers that are replicating. But then it just waits to respond to you. And so the idea is this introduces backwards compatibility. So even if your client doesn't know anything about quotas, it should, if it's a well-behaved client, wait for the ACK before it tries to produce more. In reality, many Kafka clients are not well-written or don't really adhere to this behavior, and they'll just keep throwing more data at it. And the Kafka broker will happily accept it. So it'll just keep accepting as much data as you send it and just won't respond to you. But if your client doesn't care, it'll just keep continuing. And so you end up with this case where it's sort of like an honored-based implementation of quotas. It's like, you really shouldn't send me anything, and then you just do, and it just accepts it. This actually led to another issue that we uncovered, but I'll cover that in a little bit. So yeah, if you are using Kafka and you are using produce quotas, that's something to keep in mind. With topics and consumer groups, this is kind of an unfortunate side effect of us, you know, unfortunate necessity in the way we implement in multi-tenancy, and that there is no way in Kafka, even with ACLs, to specify a numeric limit to the number of topics. So we can't say user A can create 40 topics and 200 partitions. The ACLs don't have that kind of granularity. So in order for us to impose those limits, instead we actually split the control plane from Kafka and Heroku. So the idea is we remove the ability to create topics dynamically through the admin APIs, and instead we force the customer to go through the Heroku API in order to create these topics. And so that gives us the gateway, the point, the entry point in order to enforce these limits. So for the most part, that's not really an issue. Most of our users wish that they could dynamically create topics in consumer groups, but in reality, it's not really a blocker in most cases. So last sort of major topic in configuration that I want to cover is guardrails. And so the idea here is to limit potential bad usage. So customers may use clients that are poorly written because their language doesn't have like a great supported client. Or they may misconfigure the client in a way that introduces bad behavior that could cause instability or other performance issues. And so there's this quote, which I've heard many times in Heroku, but I'm actually not sure who said it initially. But essentially, it's customers don't make mistakes, we make bad tools. And the idea is, if we give the opportunity for a customer to make a mistake and behave badly, then it's actually on us. Like, we shouldn't have let them do that. And so wherever possible, we try to build in these guardrails. We try to put things in place to prevent customers from making mistakes, essentially. And so some of the configurations that we have are on the Heroku data plane side that we actually enforce is minimum retention time. This is something that customers often ask about because it seems kind of weird. Like, why are you telling me that I should keep data around for at least this long? It seems kind of like a bizarre thing for us to enforce, but through our testing, and if you look through the mailing lists, anything less introduces a lot of churn on the broker. And so you're basically wasting cycles, wasting IOPS, throwing out data that you could be doing something productive with. And so we found that 24 hours is kind of the sweet spot. Most customers ask us, like, why is that the minimum? But it's almost never an issue. We have a max retention time for our multi-tenant plan of 7 days. We have a default replication factor of 3, a minimum replication factor of 3, and a maximum replication factor of 3. So this should tell you that really you should have a replication of 3. We don't allow anything else. And this is kind of one of the more significant guardrails that we have in place. And some of the defaults in Kafka would not necessarily have 3. You would create a topic and it just gives you 1 replication and weird things start happening. And so we strictly enforce 3. Within Kafka itself, we've also changed the defaults, again, to make them a little bit more sane, more safe. And so the default number of partitions we set is 8. The default for Kafka itself is 1. And so With one, you aren't gaining any of the benefits of scale. That'll only reside on a single broker, and your performance will be basically pinned to a single broker's worth of throughput. And if you remember what I mentioned about quotas, essentially quotas are enforced per broker. So if you create a one partition topic and your quota is 128K, the maximum throughput you'll ever get through it is 128K because it's all going through one broker. So we default to the same number of brokers in the cluster. Again, replication 3, we're pretty serious about it. So if you missed it the first time, we're going to get it the second time. It's going to be 3. Min in sync replicas, if you're not familiar with how this works, is essentially on the Kafka broker, you can specify the number of confirmed writes from replicas before you write back to the client and you say, I have received this message. Previous releases of Kafka had it set to 1, and so I think it may have been 0, actually. So just the receiving broker says, I have got this message. And then the client would think, great, I've written it. I should continue with my life. And then that broker dies, and you've lost all your messages. And so it's kind of confusing and counterintuitive. So our default is set to 2. And most recent versions of Kafka actually have it to 2 as well. A little bit about monitoring at Heroku. We use a custom monitoring tool. It's called Observatory. It's pretty awesome. It's agentless in the sense that one of the core beliefs of Heroku data and for its monitoring is that all monitoring should be done from the outside in. So we don't actually deploy anything in the brokers or on the containers or on the servers themselves. What that gives us is this amazing power where, you know, through support or through on-call, we discover, oh, actually, there's this thing, there's this metric that we should be monitoring, and we aren't. So we basically teach our monitoring tool how to look at that thing, and now that metric is being exposed across every single instance in our fleet. So we push some code, and now a million databases are now telling us something new. It's pretty spectacular. It's like one of the best things that we've come up with, I think. JMX is pretty great, and so JMX is purely a Java thing, which is not great. But Kafka itself exposes a ton of metrics about every aspect, everything you could possibly want from your Kafka broker, JMX can tell you. But it's Java only, which sucks. Jalokia is a HTTP proxy for JMX. And so when we deploy Kafka, we deploy Jalokia with it. And that basically allows us to reap the benefits of JMX without having to run Java on our control plane itself, or the monitoring, actually. So that's pretty fantastic, and I highly recommend it. So testing. I mentioned we did a ton of testing. This was pretty grueling. We tested a ridiculous number of permutations on number of partitions, maximum number of partitions. What kind of throughput should we provide for each tenant? What's the maximum that we can get? Looking at different message sizes. Kafka behaves very differently if you send lots of very small messages or very large messages. What about common operations? So we have a huge number of partitions. We're hammering it with a million large messages. And then we decide to take one of the brokers out. Does it survive that? So there were some topologies where we're like, yes, this is the one. It's perfect. Everything works fine. And then someone says, well, let's do a rolling restart. And then it just cascades, and everything dies immediately. So yeah, we actually look through all these failure scenarios. You know, we swap out a broker, we replace one, we restart one. One of the servers just stops. An instance falls out from underneath us. So we test all of those. Similarly, failure scenarios. If you run on AWS, things will fail. If you have a large fleet, they will fail often. And so we look at those cases where, you know, we decide we're running a broker and we detach an EBS volume. Does the Kafka cluster survive that? We looked at maximum packing density. Again, this is kind of a function of partitions, mainly. But can we fit 100 tenants? Can we fit 500 tenants? What do those look like? How does it perform? What are the implications of failing over? That kind of stuff. And bugs. Bugs was kind of a painful one. We did encounter bugs, obviously. Kafka is somewhat immature. It has a crazy development cycle. It's really actively being developed all the time. So I'll cover some of those issues. But one thing which we arrived on pretty quickly, and I mentioned automation is kind of our thing, is that we want to automate testing. And so we developed an internal tool that leverages the internal Heroku APIs and basically simulates users. And so it stands up a cluster, an empty cluster. It creates 50 users. And then it creates a producer and a consumer, or many producers and consumers, for these simulated users. And we can actually define profiles for each user and say, we want 10% of our users to send very small amounts of traffic. We want 20% of them to send very large messages, but at a very slow speed. And then we want the rest of them to do like some random distribution of data. And so we can actually script this, and it's reproducible. So we release a new version, we run a new version of Kafka, we maybe tune the OS a little bit, and we say, all right, go in and hammer this cluster. And so it'll provision all the users, it'll push all this data through, and then we actually monitor it and look through the logs and say, okay, you know, this worked pretty well, or we noticed that when we did a rolling restart at this point, it struggled, it took too long to come up. So yeah, we automate everything, including our testing, in this case. Yeah, so that was pretty cool. Bugs. We found a bug while testing Kafka multi-tenant. Specifically, it affects the way the quota is enforced. It's Kafka 4725. You can look it up. We discovered this while testing. We noticed that we'd run a test, and in this particular set of tests, our test was, what happens if we set quotas to 1 megabyte, and then customers completely ignore it, and they start writing at 10 megabytes? What happens? And so quotas looked like they were being enforced, and then suddenly one of the brokers would go down, and then all the other brokers would go down. And we're confused. We're like, what is going on? Why is this happening? And so we dug into it a little bit deeper, and we found that there's a memory leak. And so the way quotas are enforced is, as I mentioned, it's delayed by the way they slow you down is by holding onto the response. So they don't ACK your response until it's ready to do so, which would meet your quotas. But essentially what that meant was they were holding on to a reference of that message. So you kept sending me data, and I just keep holding on to more and more references to these messages that you sent. And so memory would go through the roof, JVM would sort of kill it because you ran out of memory, and the broker would go down. And then all of your traffic would shift to the other brokers, and they would do the same thing. And so you get this cascading failure pretty quickly. So we found that. We contributed a PR, and it was accepted and fixed in 0.10.1.1. So yeah, we're pretty active in testing new releases for Kafka. That's something we do. We always provide feedback. On the mailing list, you may have seen us. Yeah, automation, it's totally our thing. Like I mentioned, we're a pretty small team, and we manage millions of databases. So we have to automate. So Kafka does a lot in terms of maintaining these clusters, in terms of like leader election and failover and that kind of stuff. But it doesn't do everything. It has no awareness of like underlying instances. So as I mentioned, if you're on AWS, instances will fail. And if you run a fleet big enough, they will fail a lot. So our mantra, I guess, is to automate everything. We necessarily have to automate as much as possible. I semi-jokingly believe that my job is to automate myself out of a job. And so if I do a really, really good job, then I will be useless and things will just run themselves. So what we do in terms of automation is we have a lot of tools for cluster resizing, for replacing nodes. So the automation itself looks at the cluster and says, my plan says I should have 8 brokers. So if I don't have 8, I should resize to get 8. And so we can literally go into the AWS console out of band and start deleting instances, and our automation will go, ah, there's something on our right. Let me bring up another node, and it'll start filling them out. Storage expansion is something I mentioned earlier. As you write more data to Kafka, we detect, oh, you're at 80% of your storage. Let's expand that. So we'll keep expanding it as much as you need, essentially, until some other part of monitoring says, hang on, you've exceeded your limit by too much. So we're gonna do something about that. We actually automate version upgrades. So although you as a customer on a multi-tenant plan can't upgrade yourself, we automate the upgrades for the entire cluster. So it's not possible for us to manually go in and start messing around with hundreds of clusters or thousands of clusters. So we basically say, OK, now we're going to upgrade all of the Kafkas to 2.1. And the automation does it. Restarts, I put a star, because it is very surprising how effective a restart is. There is the joke of, have you tried turning off and on again? That works really, really well. Actually, 90% of our pages are handled automatically by automation. And the vast majority of the automation is to restart a thing. It could be restart the service. It could be restart the instance. But yeah, turns out turning it off and on again tends to work really, really well, disproportionately well. There is always more stuff that we can automate. We really, really automate everything. Our team is really, really small. So yeah, we automate as much as possible. My colleague, Tom Crayford, has a talk about running hundreds of Kafka clusters with a team of five. I highly recommend you take a look at it. He goes into much more detail about our automation. I'm almost done, but some of the limitations, these are the unfortunate side effects of being able to provide what we do. We don't allow the admin API. We force explicit topic creation, explicit customer group, consumer group creation, no ZKeeper access. Thank you very much. I will be taking office hours somewhere nearby. And if you want to talk to me more, please do so. Thank you very much.
So when you're saying you do a lot of testing, do you test with enabled encryption on the fly? So basically, it's from client to broker, you encrypt the data. How much performance hit you see when you do the encryption?
By default, all of our multi-tenant plans require SSL encryption. So there's no way for you not to use it on multi-tenant. We do see a performance hit, but typically it's a CPU performance hit. And almost 100% of our clusters are I/O bound. And so practical implications are pretty small. The CPU doesn't run hot, but you're testing the limits of I/O on the volumes.
Do you set up any schema registry to validate those produced input data?
Unfortunately, schema registry is a Confluent product. And so we are not allowed to run a managed schema registry for you. But you can deploy it yourself.